A very warm welcome to all of you. So today I'm going to be speaking about contacts and contour. This is a very important topic with respect to restorative dentistry. So basically you need to know what are the normal contacts and contours seen in the oral cavity, I mean in the dentition. What is the importance of having the normal contacts and contours? What are faulty contacts and contours? The different matrix systems used to rebuild or restore your contact areas, and the different kinds of wedges and techniques of wedge. So basically, if you would have noticed, your facial and lingual surfaces of teeth, they are convex rather than concave. So convex is the round surface and concave is more like a scooped out surface. So generally the facial and lingual surfaces are convex, which actually protects and simulates the periodontium during the process of mastication. So what happens is when you're chewing, this convexity actually pushes the food away from the junction between the tooth and the periodontium, so that the impingement of food does not happen. So that is the normal anatomy, which is why it is important for us to actually restore it in the similar convexity. Now, coming to a contact area, what is a contact area? It is the area where one tooth is in contact with the adjacent tooth. So initially, when teeth are just erupting, it is not as much as a contact area, but a contact point, because the teeth come in contact only at a particular point. But because of your physiologic tooth movement and wear and tear, this contact point gradually becomes a contact area. So the contact area is actually a broader area when it comes to the posteriors when compared to the anteriors. And if you will notice, the contact areas are more towards the incisal third for your anteriors when compared to your posteriors, where they're located in the junction of the middle and gingival thirds. The occlusal and the middle thirds. So this is the difference in the anatomy. Now coming to the embrasures. So the embrasures are the V-shaped spaces which are present in the proximal contact area between the teeth, and they are named according to the direction towards they are towards which they are located. So you can have your facial, you can have lingual, incisal, or gingival. So this is demonstrated in the figures given here. So if you can see, you have the incisal, the occlusal, and the gingival embrasures. And what is the importance or significance of these embrasures? So they prevent the food from impinging between the teeth. This is what I was talking about, even with the help of the convexity, the natural convexity of the teeth. They prevent periodontal problems, obviously. So the periodontium is not damaged. So it prevents periodontal problems and the formation of dental caries. So in this case, it's going to be the smooth surface caries. Stabilizes the dental arches and distributes the forces of mastication. This is a very, very important point. So the forces of mastication are not concentrated at a specific area, but because of these embrasures, there is a uniform distribution of the forces. Now, coming to the anatomical considerations, you have to know about the marginal ridges, the contours, the embrasures, and the contact areas. So coming to the marginal ridges, these are a very, very important anatomic landmarks. They are essential for balancing the teeth in the arch, and they play a vital role in mastication. So basically, if you see the normal anatomy, so if you can see in the figure, this is supposed to be the normal anatomy of the marginal ridges. So if your marginal ridges are intact and at the right anatomic position, the horizontal forces, as you can see, are indicated as H1 and 2, 1H and 2H, they will oppose each other and cancel out each other. Okay, and the vertical forces are located as the number 1 and 2 in the figure. So because the 1H and 2H are present, they do not allow the vertical forces to cause impingement of food. So that means the food is not driven in gingivally because of the horizontal forces cancelling out on each other. So they help to keep the tooth in the anatomic position, and they also prevent the impingement of food or driving of food into the periodontium. So what happens in the absence of a marginal ridge? This is very, very important. So what happens is that because there is a lack of a marginal ridge, in this case of the premolar, the horizontal forces are not equal and they cannot cancel out each other, because of which there is going to be a gap between the teeth. And this is where the vertical forces, which come into play during mastication, they actually drive in or wedge in the food in between the teeth. This is when you see the patient, they commonly complain about food getting stuck in between the teeth. So this is what happens when you don't have a proper marginal ridge. So this is these are the other scenarios wherein you can see that there is an improper height for the marginal ridge in the molar and in the premolar in the two figures given below. So the principle is the same. So because the horizontal forces are not equal and opposite to each other, they are not able to keep the teeth in place, and there is a gap which forms when you are chewing, that is the vertical forces, and because of that the food gets wedged in interdentally, yeah, and this is what leads to periodontal problems and the formation of smooth surface caries. So what are facial and lingual contours? They are the uniform curvature at the cervical and the middle third. And the role of the contours, explained before, they play a prime role in protecting the gingiva and stimulation of the soft tissue during mastication. So that helps in maintaining proper health of the soft tissues, that is the periodontium as well. And the embrasures and spillways, the embrasures, they act as spillways for the escape of food. So those wide areas which are seen just below the contact areas, they actually act as spillways for food to escape, and they prevent food from being forced into the contact area. So that is why the embrasures are extremely important. This is why when we restore a tooth, we prefer not to do it freehand, but with the help of matrix systems. Yeah. So there are different types of contact areas which are seen in a normal anatomy. You can have a tapering contact area, as you can see in the figure. You can have the square type, and you can also have the ovoid type. So the ovoid is the transition between the tapering and the square, and you will see all these kinds of contact areas in the normal dentition. So depending upon the kind of contact area which is seen in the normal dentition, you have to try and rebuild it in a similar fashion. Yeah. So how do you restore the contact and contour? You have to induce a slight tooth movement, that is with the help of your wedges. Then of course you have to use a suitable matrix, and then you have to utilizing the matrix and the wedges, you have to restore the tooth with a suitable restorative material. Yeah. So intraorally you have different matrix systems and wedges, which I will be discussing in the future slides, but the extraorals, you also can restore the tooth using cast metal restorations, or you can also use ceramic inlays or onlays. Yeah, so that is fabricated with the help of either a direct or an indirect wax pattern. So the tooth movement is the act of separating the involved teeth from each other, and this is done so that you can actually restore the interproximal surface of the tooth. Yeah. So what are the indications of the other indications for tooth movement? One is to diagnose your interproximal caries, and it's also done for removing of foreign bodies, apart from creating the space for your matrix band and for finishing and polishing of the restoration which you need to do interproximally. Yeah, so there are two types or two principles of tooth separation. You can either have your rapid or you can have your slow movement, and basically what we prefer to use is the rapid movement in the clinics, because the slow, as the name suggests, it takes a very long time, but the slow or delayed tooth movement is less traumatic. But because it is an immediate procedure, we do not mind using the rapid tooth movement. So the slow or delayed tooth movement is you can use your orthodontic wires to actually gradually cause separation of the teeth. You can use an oversized temporary. So you wedge in an oversized temporary restoration in the teeth, and because of that bulky restorative material, the teeth adjacent to the tooth of interest will actually start drifting away from it. And then of course when you remove the temporary restoration after a specific a considerable amount of time, you will actually see that there is a gap between the teeth. Yeah, so but then we do not generally practice these methods because we want to finish it off on the same visit. So coming to the rapid or immediate tooth movement, we have two principles. We have the traction method and we have the wedge method. So in the traction, we have the true separator and the Ferrier double bow separator, not so commonly used nowadays. And the wedge method is the more commonly used, wherein we use the plastic or the wooden wedges. Yeah, so here you can see the traction method and the wedge methods. So in the traction method, you have the Ferrier double bow and the true separators, and for the wedge method you have the Elliott separator and the wooden wedges. So we prefer to use wooden wedges when compared to the plastic because of the fact that wood absorbs moisture and swells up. So it actually, you know, expands and actually gives us a better space between the adjacent teeth, because of which we can restore the contour and contact in a better fashion. So coming to matricing, what is matricing? It is the procedure wherein a temporary wall is created so that you can restore the tooth structure which was lost during the preparation or because of caries attacks. So what are the requirements? It's very simple. It should be easy to insert. It should be able to resist the pressure which is created at the time of condensation of your restorative material. And it should possess the exact three-dimensional contour of the final restoration. So it should take that shape. It should be immobile during the setting of the restorative material. This, of course, is not an issue now because this is the era of light cured restorative materials. This criteria used to be when at the time when we used to restore the teeth using amalgams or direct filling gold, when, you know, this requirement used to be more important. It should not react with or adhere to the restorative material, very important, and it should be easily removable. And in the case of the tooth colored filling restorative materials, it should allow the light to pass through. So the Mylar strip is a very good example of a matrix band which actually allows the light to pass through for proper curing. So the functions of matricing are it substitutes for the lost wall of the tooth structure, helps to play a role in restoration of contact and contour, and it confines the restorative material within the prepared cavity. So more often than not, if you do not place the matrix band properly, you will see that the restorative material is actually flowing either gingivally or, you know, buccally or lingually. So that becomes an excess flash of restorative material. So not using the matrix actually tends to landslide the restorative material. In the olden days, it used to be amalgam during the condensation. So that is why a matrix band is very, very important. So how much should be the extent of your matrix band? Occlusally, it should extend at least 1 to 2 mm above the marginal ridge so that you have sufficient amount of space to actually carry out your carving and proper space for your condensation of your restorative material. And gingivally, preferably it should go 1 mm below the gingival margin so that you can get a proper finish of a subgingival restoration as well. Yeah, so coming to the classification of matrices, we have various classifications. So based on the mode of retention, you have your mechanically retained or you can have your self-retained. Based on the transparency, you have your non-transparent and your transparent. The transparent, the best example is your Mylar strip. Based on the encircling of the tooth, you can have the unilateral. The best example would be your number one matrix band. The circumferential, that is which totally encircles the tooth, the best example is your Toffelmeyer system. The sectional matrices, the best examples are the Palodent, which is now available in our department, the Palodent system. So that is actually one of the best systems, and it will be discussed with about in the further slides. And contour, of course, you have your pre-contoured and your uncontoured bands, and depending on the thickness, you have your thin and your thick bands as well. So custom contouring, this is nothing but burnishing of the band just before you place it or during the placement. If you see that there is a crink or, you know, a bend in the band, you can actually take out the band and you can just burnish it in the area of the defect, thereby producing the rounded or convex surface which was originally present. Yeah. So these are the different kinds of retainers which are present today. So you have the number one, the number eight, the Sequiland, the auto matrix, the Teufelmayer, the compound matrix, compound supported matrix, and the pre-contour, that is your Palladint systems. So the Teufelmayer is the most important for you guys. The number one is actually a very good example of the unilateral kind of the matrix system, where only one surface of the tooth is actually exposed to the matrix band. And then we have the number eight, which actually looks like the number one for me, and this can be used it encircles the entire surface of the tooth, so it's not unilateral but circumferential. Yeah, and here we have a video. I have shared a link on how to use the Sequiland. It's no longer used now because it's not very convenient to actually place it, but I have shared a video, so you can have a look. If you have any doubts, you can contact me. The Automatrix is another system whereby you can actually, these are all the circumferential kinds of bands and matrix retainers which can be used, so you can have a look. It's no longer used, we don't generally use it over here. And the Teufelmayer is of extreme importance, and I'm sure you're all aware of how to use it. So it has a small knurled nut which helps to open and close the band. The large knurled nut is used to adjust the size of the loop or the band. And then we have the locking vise and the neck, wherein the locking vise is actually used to secure the band to the retainer, and the head, of course, you can either, depending upon the side which has to be restored, the band comes out to either the left or to the right side of the retainer. So a video has been attached for you guys to actually see, in case if you're if you just want to refresh your memory on how to place the Teufelmayer matrix band. The compound supported matrix, it's actually a very simple process. So basically, we do not have a retainer as per se, but we just place the matrix band around the surface of the tooth, which needs an artificial wall for the buildup. And then that retainer is actually kept in place with the help of impression compound, which is heated and allowed to cool around the margins of the matrix band. And as you can see, this is how it is being kept. And then, of course, it is stabilized with the help of the wedges. So then you are able to do your tooth buildup. So this can be done in cases where you have a grossly decayed tooth and you actually have to do a kind of core buildup. So in these cases, you can actually, you know, have a circumferential kind of a retentive band all over, because it is supported by your impression compound. So it's going to be stable while you can do the core buildup. Now coming to the sectional bands, they are pre-contoured and they're available in different kinds of sizes. And the Palladint is a perfect example for the sectional. For your anteriors, you have the mylar strips, which are the most common. These also can be secured with the help of light emitting wedges also. And these can be used to restore your anterior teeth and used for restoring with tooth colored restorative materials, because they help the light to pass through. Transparent celluloid crowns, not so much in use now, but I believe they're still used in the department of periodontics in the form of strip crowns, where you can actually do the restorations for deciduous teeth. The anatomic matrices, again, not very much in use, because now we prefer to do a freehand buildup, because we have proper restorative materials which set in the presence of light. But in the olden times, when we did not have it and we wanted to carve back with the natural anatomy, we actually used to, you know, support it with the help of impression compound. And, we used to place the matrix band, the mylar strip used to be cut out according to the shape of the cavity which is prepared, and then we used to actually condense the restorative material with the help of this anatomic matrix which used to be formed with the help of impression compound. Yeah, and this mylar strip will actually push the restorative material in the cavity and conform to the anatomical borders of the cavity. Now coming to the wedging, this is again very, very important. So the prevention, the functions of wedging are, it actually prevents a gingival overhang, and it helps in close adaptability of the band to the tooth, especially in the subgingival areas. It also provides a rapid separation of the teeth to compensate for the thickness of the band, and it stabilizes the matrix. Yeah, so it's a very, very important component of your matrixing system. And these are the specifications of the wedges. They should be at least 9 to 12 mm in length, and they should be, we can lubricate it for easy placement. You can use your Vaseline so that, you know, it slides through and it doesn't cause too much of discomfort to the patient. And it is usually placed from the lingual surface rather than from the buccal because of the wider embrasion. Unless and until you feel that the patient's tongue is really large and it's causing a hindrance, and you know, it might traumatize the tongue of the patient as well. Yeah, so basically we have two different major types of in context to the shape. So you can have the round wedge and you can also have the triangular wedge. So the round wedge is used in conservative proximal boxes because the wedging action is required in a more occlusal direction, whereas the triangular wedges can be recommended for deep gingival caries lesions. Yeah, because it can actually replicate the anatomy subgingival. Yeah, and regarding the material, we have our plastic and wooden. I'm sure you're all aware of it. So the wooden are actually the medicated orange wood wedges. So these swell up in the presence of moisture and actually give a more accurate fit interdentally when compared to the plastic ones. Yeah, so here you can see the difference between the triangular and the round or the circular wedges. So in the subgingival or in the deep caries lesions, that is extending subgingivally, we can see that the triangular wedge will give a better anatomical fit when compared to the round ones, which are preferred for more occlusal occlusally placed restorations. Okay, so yeah, so these are your anatomic wedges also, which these are generally given alongside your palatodentate system because they actually help with the proper fit, especially for areas with tight contacts. Yeah, so the different kinds of wedging techniques, these are very, very important. So the single wedging is the most is the easiest one. So you either place it from the buccal side or from the lingual. Like I said before, placing from the lingual side is easier because of the wider embrasure space. So the double wedging is when, you know, you have extremely wide contact areas, that means extremely wide gaps between the teeth. So you have to, you end up placing a wedge from both the buccal as well as from the lingual side. The piggyback wedging, similar to the name, how we actually carry kids, you know, when they are young on the piggyback. So it's the easy way to remember. So you just have a larger wedge below and a significantly smaller wedge is placed on top of it. So this is done for deeper caries lesions and, you know, the restorations which end up going subgingivally. So in these cases, when you need to secure the band even subgingivally, you can use your piggyback wedging. When it comes to caries which is present on the proximal surfaces where a concavity may be present, like in the case of your maxillary first premolar, in such cases you can use your wedge wedging. So in this case, you actually have to, you know, place one wedge in the horizontal fashion and one wedge in the vertical fashion. So this is used to actually fill up the gap which is present because of the concavity in the root surface of your maxillary first premolar. Yeah. Now, this is what I was talking about, the recent advances in the matrix systems. So you have the palladent and the compositite. So we have the palladent system in the department, so you guys can have a look later when you are free. And the compositite is very, very similar to the palladent. I have attached links which beautifully explain the use of the palladent and the compositite restorative procedures, so you guys can have a look. And this is what I was talking about for you know, taking a direct wax pattern for your extra oral restorative procedures, that is your cast metal or your ceramic or your composite, even the inlays and the onlays. So once the cavity is prepared, you actually have to take a wax impression or a wax pattern. So you can either take it directly in the mouth, or you can actually create it indirectly in the lab after taking a full mouth impression. So this will be discussed more in detail when you have your cast metal restorations lecture. So you need not worry too much about it, but it's always good to know that you can have a direct and an indirect wax pattern for your extraoral restorative procedures. So these are the hazards of faulty restoration. So what happens when you have extremely broad contacts? So then you don't have proper spillways for the escape of food, you know, and food will get stuck in the periodontal area, causing secondary caries, I mean, causing caries attacks as well as periodontal problems. If you have too narrow contacts also, the distribution of forces is going to be difficult, you know. The contact area has to be bulky so that, I mean, it should be relatively thick, and you should have a good proper marginal ridge anatomy. Otherwise, the transmission of forces is not going to be too good. If there are problems, if your marginal ridges are too occlusally or too lingually, or I mean, or too gingivally placed, or, you know, if they are too buccally or lingually placed also, because all the embrasures anatomy starts changing respectively, yeah, respective to the opposite direction of the marginal ridge. So in those cases, your normal anatomy is also going away, because of which the food impingement is definitely going to be an issue. And of course, it also causes the lack of uniform transmission of forces. Open contacts, again, we generally tend not to give this open contact unless and until you want to make a tooth in a self-cleansing area, but that is generally done in very, very rare selective cases. So we prefer not to give open contacts, because that will also cause a tremendous amount of food lodgement and, you know, the possibility of having another caries attack in that region. So we give it in very, very selective and very, very rare cases. We prefer not to give open contacts until and unless there's no other way out. Yeah. Okay. So this was it from my side on contacts and contours. So if you guys have any doubts, you can feel free to approach me. I'll be more than happy to actually help and guide you out. But if not, that's all from my side, guys. So take care and stay safe.